in one area in particular. Maybe you've never thought about this. I will tell you what your trouble is. The trouble is that all day long you have a new atmosphere practically every minute, a new mental, psychic, psychological atmosphere. This is your problem. A different one every minute, and it conflicts with the one you had the minute before. And this one in which you are not in charge of yourself at all, but what is in charge of you is what happens to you in the room with the other people, or what happens when you step on the scale and see you've gained 5 pounds or lost 5 pounds and didn't want to. Try to see that there is only one atmosphere. At each moment, you are that atmosphere at that moment. This is what you are at that moment, but it's a wrong atmosphere. You look at it and you'll see that it's one of tension, of wishing that it wasn't your state, your atmosphere at all, but you don't know what to do about it. Let me get back to the original point. This is astonishing when you see it. You, each one of you, can be your own right atmosphere 24 hours of the day, regardless of where you are, regardless of that challenge, regardless of that neurotically crushing world that you're in, that idiot of a boss you have, that slyly cruel spouse you have, that screaming teenage child you have. Why do you sacrifice your mind to anyone or anything when it's not necessary to do so? Because you think it's necessary. You think it's necessary because you have not gone into this with a total determination to understand your mind, really understand it. I said really understand it. And understand that in your original nature, your original mind, it is in fact free of everything, including your own neurotic accumulations. So that at times you can be quite serious, as we are now. At other times you can be light. Other times you can be examining things. But all the time, you are in charge. To review just a little bit, I'm going to give you some facts. And it is quite likely, perhaps some of you new people, some of you others, have never been told this before. So this is a marvelous night for you. Whether you know it or not, it's a marvelous night. Now know it by digging into this. Wouldn't it be nice to have a mind, to have a nature that remains in charge of itself at all times, so that you're not the slave of those relatives of yours, which you are now, right? They can write you letters and tell you their troubles, and you feel depressed, and you feel that you had better give them something that you don't want to give them. You somehow feel that you're being imposed on, but you don't know what to do about it because you were told that it's the right thing to help other people, and you're so baffled by it. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to read a letter from your relative or read the headlines and not be thrown by it, but to see it with understanding. And we'll find out how to get to that in a minute. To be in command of yourself instead of being a slave to yourself. This is what we're after in this room, and this is what we're going to get. It's going to take a lot of hard work, because we've been piling these things up all these years without questioning them. So what we're doing tonight and other nights is questioning this mad life that we are now living. Now don't you resist that. And don't you be afraid of the word mad. Wait till you see how bad it is, and then I'll congratulate you for seeing it. If you want to run away from the facts, then you can do that. That's very easy to do. You can close your mind to it, as you've been doing all your life up until your present age. Go ahead, just close your mind. And stay terrified. Do you like the life you're now living? You're not sure, are you? Because you're in conflict over it. Part of you is quite satisfied with the way things are going. Financially, you're not bad off. You have a good husband or wife or boyfriend or girlfriend. Things aren't too bad. Then how come you break down so often? How come you have hostility? How come you have hostility in you that you hope nobody sees? And you hope you can mask it with a proper facial expression? It's very painful, is it not, to have hostility? So let's start back, a little farther back, and examine something. We're going to be very logical. You might want to write some of these things down. You understand, do you not, when you write things down, it's the same thing as reading a book, so you're writing them down and reading them later, just like you'd read a book. You buy a book for information, write your own notes down, and look at them when you get home. That's the value of it, if you like to write things down. Have you ever questioned yourself and asked what happens to a thought, when it appears in your mind? What happens to it? Have you ever looked at it? Just looked at it. Sat all alone in your couch at home, watch your mind operating, see a thought rise, and then see what happens to it. Have you ever done that? You do it sometime. This is your work. But we'll do something else with it tonight. Very simply, broken down as simply as we can. When you have a thought of any kind, reaction to something that someone said, a private thought that you don't want others to see, where is this thought that comes into your mind going to fall? It can only fall in one of three places. And these three steps I'm going to give you, these three places, are the steps by which we find our way out of the personal mess which you are in, and your neighbor, and your friend, and your relatives, and your parents, and your children, and everybody else. Oh, you understand, I'm asking if you want out of it. If you don't want out, then this doesn't apply, but if you want out, then this applies. Okay. A thought comes into your mind. What happens to it? First of all, it can fall on your misunderstanding. Now, what are some ideas about misunderstanding? A thought can be very, very unacceptable to you if you have a moral code. And you think you owe somebody something, and so you feel a thought that you owe something to someone else. And you're all confused about it. What are you going to do with it? You're going to feel guilty? That is the second thought that we talked about. And already you're in trouble. If you started the mechanical machine of your mind going, and you'll walk 10 blocks without knowing you've walked 10 blocks, or work all morning long without knowing what you've been doing because your mind has been carried away by this first thought that set in motion a series of other mechanical thoughts which made your day a hell. You know, you can take a small hand grenade and set it off inside an armory beside a munitions storehouse, and that one small hand grenade can blow up the half the countryside. We'll get back to this, but let me ask you a question. You think? I'll tell you something. It's very dangerous for most human beings to think. Right? No argument there? To think with a reaction, for example. You hear that someone else who is younger than you, I'm just pulling examples out of the air, you find your own. Those of you listening to this tape, you find your own. Because you're in trouble just like everyone else is, are you not? Yes. Don't lie about it, for heaven's sake. If we can stop lying, we're on the right track. So I have a thought in my mind that you make a lot more money than I do, and you have a lot less education. You didn't go to college like I did. You're 10 years younger. And through some chance or circumstance, you make twice as much money as I do. I even hear the fact that you make twice as much money. I think a thought that is dangerous to me, right? I'm jealous. I'm resentful. So unfortunately, with the vast majority of human beings on this earth, all thoughts are dangerous because the danger falls on itself and recreates more. Let's get some synonyms for what happens when a thought goes wrong. It falls in the mind on resistance, on what? On jealousy, on any kind of negativity, on timidity, on fear, on so-called prayer that God or someone else is going to help you, which means you've abandoned your own mind to something else, to someone else. And heaven help this person you depend on if you ever turn against them. You ever turned against someone you were depending on, huh? You loved, quote me. So with most human beings, thoughts are simply a dangerous battlefield, well concealed, all covered up. And that individual, what? Lives in hell. Lives in the jungle of his own mind. He's miserable, he's afraid, he doesn't know which way to turn. One minute he's all excited about something, the next minute he's depressed. This describes our lives, doesn't it? This is the way we live. Okay. All right. What can we do? Do we have to continue this way? I know, and some of you know, that it's not necessary to continue to live in the jungle. There is a way out. With right work, right intentions, by stopping our infernal lying and self-deception, and by ceasing, I'll give you a phrase, you'll remember this when I give it to you. We can get out by ceasing to be a psychological charlatan. You know what a charlatan is? A charlatan is a social charlatan, is someone who deceives other people. He cons them, gets their money, gives them an inferior product. In some way, he cons them out of the something that he wants from them. You know, we can be psychological charlatans and deceive ourselves and rob ourselves of something that does not have to be of the jungle. That's a good way to look at it. Because then maybe I can see what I am doing to myself and get tired of it. So tired that I'm willing in a small way at the start to say no to anyone else who might scorn me if I start to think in a different way, who might leave me if I say I'm going to change my life drastically. And I'll repeat for the benefit of those of you who have not heard this very fundamental thought for the first time. When you really seriously go into this with a determination that you're not going to put up with your own nonsense anymore, or the nonsense of other people, all your social relations will change and must change, because most people do not want to go into it, don't want to go into the hard work, don't want to go into the humiliation of seeing what nitwits they've been all their lives, nitwits with college degrees, and nitwits who write books and give talks, and nitwits who make $1 million, and who dress fine, and who are young and pretty, and who are old and dignified, nitwits all. We're tired of the masquerade. Tired enough. So that now, a thought, we think, falls in a second place, a different place. It falls on my wish and your determination to understand. Now, what on earth is simpler than that? And what is different than the first step of falling on my misunderstanding, on my neurosis? It's falling in a new place, on my wish to understand. I can't control it yet. I have all these violent thoughts and all these sex urges, and all these angers and frustrations. I want to blow up the world. I get so mad sometimes. But I'm going to understand it. Instead of feeling guilty and feeling ashamed of myself, I'm going to try to understand why my mind operates as it does. Tremendous. Already, I've begun to think in a new way. As simple as that, I've made a tremendous change of direction. I haven't gone very far. Three steps. But it's a different direction, and I will guarantee you, if you do this already, you'll begin to feel, not think, feel this new atmosphere that we talked about at the very beginning, which is your atmosphere, which is free of the sickness of your own mind and of that world out there. Now I've arrived at the stage of hard work, of starting every day fresh, no matter how stupid I was yesterday, and my stupidity is unbelievable. When I was totally asleep, you would never have convinced me that I was such a big liar, that I am now seeing that I am, that I was such a hypocrite. Ooh, what a shock. But I'm getting honest. Hard daily work, starting every day. Now, let's get a little more specific than that. Listen, starting every second right here in this room as a fresh second, as if I have no past, because I don't. You think you have a past? You have none at all. Sorry, but you're not a guilty sinner who hurt people 10 years ago. Sorry, you're not that. And you're not a faithful wife who's been faithful to your husband, your faithful husband. You're labeling yourself in order to keep a pseudo-identity going from second to second, which is what keeps you miserable. But you don't know it yet. But we're discovering, we're finding out, this is what keeps me miserable, because I don't know what's going to keep it affirmed in the next second. So I'll invent a lie that God will save me, or I'll get a new husband or a promotion. You and I are fresh this second. This is one of the understandings that I'm beginning to gain by putting all these pieces of the jigsaw puzzle together. I get one corner of it. I have six pieces, and it begins, thank God. That's okay. That's all right. Thank God it begins to make sense. We didn't know there was a way out, did we? Did we? We thought we had to lie and be somebody. And have power. We thought we had to fawn before other people in order to keep them in our lives. So something different is happening internally to you and to me. So I make the determination, I make the aim with all the feeling I can get to intensify my work. I don't care what it is. If I can start with such a simple elementary thing as putting a sign on the living room table or in my wallet where I'll see it every once in a while, any helpful sign, it can be anything. It could be a simple phrase that says, come home. Now I know what that means. You know what that means. Come home to myself. Okay, I'm out there working in the shop, in the field, wherever I work, in the office. And someone makes a negative remark. In all my life, when someone made a negative remark in the past, I've got upset by it, resentful of it, whatever. But I saw that sign when I got up and left the house, and it said, come home. I didn't have to put the whole sentence out because I know what it means. I hear the remark. I understand that I can come home right now and not be carried away by that sarcastic expression, by that wrong expression of any kind on that man's face, on that woman's face. I come home to me, who I really am. Not this weak, coward little person who thinks he has to be scared and resentful all day long. This is what is known as self-work. This is what is known is finding the way out. This is what is known as beginning to be an honest, real human being. And then I think of a dozen other ways which I can work on myself all day long. Never being ashamed when I flop, because I'll be doing that all day long. Never being envious of anyone who has anything of worldly goods, to put it that way. Or of anyone who is younger than I am, or who I think is wiser than I am. But coming home, see, I've got it. I can come home to myself. Till little by little, it becomes quite clear to me, what it means to come home and stay there. So that I am always there, which is my own pure atmosphere, 24 hours of the day. Regardless of how it appears to you, I'm home. Because you may think I am like you are. I used to be. But I get fed up with living that way. And I don't tell you I'm spiritual or anything, you understand. I know that I'm home, regardless of how it appears to you. Because you're projecting your own atmosphere and thinking that I'm like you. Nah, we won't go into that. Finally, I come to the third step, third place, where from the moment I get up, all day long, all night long, all thoughts, when thoughts are quite necessary, and we need thousands of thoughts every day. That's part of our whole psychic system, to think thoughts. That's part of us. All these thoughts now fall on a different place. They don't fall on my negative attitudes anymore. They don't fall on my sickness, on my neurosis, on my hardness anymore. They don't even fall on my attempt to understand anymore. They fall up. A thought fell on a right thought. A negative reaction might have fallen on a right thought. For example, I got angry and I said, now that's not right because it's not necessary. It's not necessary. So that was a right thought there. In this third stage, it doesn't even fall on that because there's no thought involved. Not that kind of thought anyway. Life, including my life, falls on my pure understanding, which is a different kind of reaction than the other two. Because I've worked hard. Ooh, I've worked hard. And never deceiving myself that I've reached the top of the mountain. Never saying that, because that could be a deception, could it not? Okay, where am I? Well, I'm at the point, and you'll understand this. I'm at the point where, having no life of my own, I have a life of my own. Right? I don't have the previous life of my own where I wanted to be somebody, or I wanted you to flatter me, or I wanted someone else to save me, as if they can. Through going deeply into this, through understanding, this'll do something with some of you. I think we're leaving God out of this. I've come to the point where I understand that indeed, in fact, there is only God. There's only truth. Only reality. Having got rid of my lies and my artificiality, having got rid of my dreadful pretenses which wear me out all day long. I'm so tired of pretending, aren't you? Aren't you tired of pretending? Having got rid of that, I'm now living in freedom from it, and for the first time have a life of my own. Thank heaven. This is our aim. Now let's do it. Try some time asking yourself, especially when you're busy. It's easy to work when things are quiet around you, you're home alone or driving the car. Sometime when it's difficult to come home, do it. And ask yourself, what is my state of mind right now? Have you ever done that? How many of you have done this? Try to understand the state of mind you're in right at the second. And then examine what we have called your atmosphere at that time. Because it won't just be the thought, will it? It could affect your physical body, your tense, maybe. You're excited, maybe. Your emotions are racing around. What is my state right now? Do you know that is your world? And do you know that that world, that whole world, can change magically, instantly, by dropping the thought? Because that's all it is. That's what your world consists of. That is what you consist of, what you're thinking of at the moment. That is what you are. That is you at that moment. How are you going to change the next moment? By not going into the second thought, which keeps the one domino from hitting the next domino. Now, what would you like to talk about? Do any of you feel enslaved by anyone else in this world? How about society as a whole? Do you feel pressured by society, by the economic system? Why do you take it? Why do you sit back, and say, this is the easy course, so I'll take it? Because there's nothing I can do about it anyway. You know what you're saying when you say that? You're saying, I prefer to remain part of the madness. I prefer to remain in this mad world with maybe the opportunity. You think you're not saying this? I'm telling you that you are, and you had better be shocked by seeing it. You persecuted me this minute. It'll be my turn the next minute. That's what keeps me going. Can you think of anything more horrible than being kept alive by hatred? You're not even shocked by that, are you, B? Because you don't think it applies to you, do you? Who are you trying to kid? Huh? Who are you trying to kid? Go ahead and kid yourself if you want. And be afraid. Or you can rise up in rebellion and go through your own guilts and shames, go right through the heart of them and suffer intensely from them. But suffering in a new way, which will destroy them once and for all. Once and for all. So that they can't get you again. So that you, listen to this, listen. So that you can't torment yourself anymore. Wouldn't that be nice? We never quite succeed in kidding ourselves, do we? We never quite succeed in making the deception cover the agony, cover the pain, cover the anger. Oh, this business of anger. Oh. I only see the tip of the iceberg of it, but boy, am I smoldering inside. I'm talking about you in this room. Am I not? No? I will ask you who you think you're kidding. And I'm talking to those of you listening to this tape. Who do you think you're kidding? Yeah. Oh. Isn't it nice to know that you can't get away with it in this room? Isn't that encouraging? Isn't that one of the happiest thoughts you've ever heard? That you won't be lied to in order to keep your lie going. Because it's been pretty miserable up until now, hasn't it? What kind of a decision are any of you in this room or listening to this tape, what kind of a decision are you going to make, having heard these things tonight? You understand you already have? You've already made a decision of one kind or another. And it would be unconscious to you. You won't know. You won't see. because, now change the figure of speech a little bit, because when you're psychologically deaf, that is, you hear words and think you understand them, when you're psychologically deaf, you don't know you are. You don't know you are. How can I tell you are when you don't know it, when you don't understand what I'm talking about? What's our salvation? Shock. Shock. Even that has to be taken rightly. And I will ask all of you again, all of you, when you go away from this meeting tonight, you listen to what you say to the person you came with. Just listen to yourself talk. Ask yourself, why did I say that? Why am I talking this way? Why am I talking this way? Find out. Then maybe you could find out why you're always so afraid. And why you have all this suppressed hostility in you, which is unnecessary. You have to go on this endure the pain of it, endure the shock, endure not having what you have always had psychologically and maybe even physically, endure doing without it. I'll start over. Go through the shock of not having what you now have, which you call your life, for heaven's sake. What kind of a life do you have? And you cling to that? That's what you fight for? You resist the truth that is given to you in order to hang on to your sickness? Your violence? Yes. Because this is the only world you know. This is all you know, and you're afraid to be without that world. Now, have the courage, even if it's a little bit at the start, to begin to do without what you have called your life, what you have called your attitudes, your convictions, your beliefs. What have your beliefs given you? What have they given you up till now? And you're hanging on to that? Isn't it the strangest thing imaginable about us that we refuse to throw out the poison in the cupboard for fear of the emptiness of the cupboard? If I will have the courage to throw out the poison, it will be replaced with something that is healthy, that is wholesome, that is right, and that is decent. What an odd bunch of creatures we are that we won't throw out what is poisoning us. Oh, you don't call it poison though, do you? You call it a Christian faith. God help you. You need it. You know, shall I tell you one of the greatest vanities on earth, which will help us, help all of us? One of the greatest vanities you and I could have is the fear. Now listen to this, you listen to it. One of our greatest vanities is the fear that someone or something can injure us. You examine your life right now, and you find out where you fear that someone or something, society, an individual, that someone or something can hurt you. And that is pure vanity. Because you're thinking about yourself getting hurt. All right, let's get right back to it. Who gets hurt? You think about that a little bit. So can we have the courage to not be afraid that anyone or anything can hurt us? And we're not talking about physically. We are careful when we cross the street, are we not? So that we don't hurt ourselves physically, psychologically, mentally, emotionally. Who gets hurt? If there's no one there to get hurt, who can hurt you? There's no one there. Who's there? When there's someone at home, there's nobody home. Right? Try to hurt truth. Impossible. That's the answer. If I am truth, if you are truth, you tell me. You tell me. I'm waiting. Tell me. How can you get hurt? You can't tell me. One of the greatest pleasures of life is to consciously enter a situation where you are afraid in any way, afraid of losing something, afraid you won't make it, or you're afraid to consciously enter this situation and stick right with it until it destroys itself. What an authentic pleasure that is. Then you're eager, you get eager to work harder on yourself, to find more, to drop more chains. This is real fun. I don't know about you, but I don't know anything on earth that is more fun than this. This was supposed to be open discussion. Go ahead. This nice and loud and clear.
Probably won't make any sense. I read somewhere back in a book, quit being good to people, all right? Then I asked myself, I don't mean to be foolish. If I quit being good to people, how am I going to get what I want? And is that goodness?
Comment? You want to comment on your own comment?
Yes. My idea of goodness is an idea of goodness, and it is not goodness. Because when I do good to you or you, back behind my mind, later you owe me a goodness which isn't goodness.
Yeah, a motive of a reward. Yeah, right. A motive of reward.
Correct.
I repeat the question. Have you ever noticed how difficult you find it to identify, to see, and to understand what you call your enemy? Who is the enemy? Well, we can look out at the physical world and see the enemy as another human being, perhaps someone we've had a quarrel with. It can be the boss, it can be the wife or husband, it can be a distant relative, it can be the opposite political party, it can be another nation. Who is the enemy? What do you think would happen if you ceased trying to find the enemy? You know what would happen, don't you? Do you? The enemy, and that should be put in quote marks all the time, the enemy, in quote mark, would cease to exist. And then you would have no enemy, no enemies at all. I said none. But unfortunately, for most human beings, and maybe us too, we'd have to find out, enemies become quite necessary, quote marks again, quite necessary in order to keep our false personality in place. If I can fight someone, I'm a fighter. Therefore, at least I have that kind of a label, and I have an aliveness from fighting and hating and disputing with other people. And that's my identity, and that's my misery. But that's not what we're going to go into particularly this morning. But you might ask yourself, what would happen if I simply dropped the idea, I said the idea of having enemies? You find it, as someone said earlier this morning, you would find a tremendous resistance to that idea. Because enemies become necessary to our pseudo, our false existence. This is why in a severely neurotic state, or even in a mildly neurotic state, we seek out enemies, seek out persecution, because it makes us feel alive, makes us feel like someone. That is what is known as living death. Right here in this physical body, we can be spiritually asleep, hypnotized, use the term you want. All right. How do you react when you are told that you don't understand something? Especially when you consider yourself in your mind an authority on some particular subject. Spirituality, psychology, right living, for example. How do you feel when told that you don't really know what you're talking about? Pretty much of a blow to the vanity, isn't it? Especially if you have a degree on the wall that says you can give counsel in right living to other people, and someone tells you you're a psychic charlatan. Pretty hard, isn't it? As a preface to a very important topic this morning, I want to tell all of you that you don't know what you're talking about. That you're living in delusion. Each one of you here, without exception, without knowing, without seeing that you're doing so. When I tell you that you do not know what a part of you assumes you know, I'm saying that because that is a very necessary first lesson in actual knowing. what is behind my false assumptions, my fiery and angry insistence that I know what I'm doing with my life. What is behind it? Oh, what is behind it besides misery? Because that will be accompanied by misery, which I keep conceal from you very carefully, because I'm a good actor, or you're a good actress. I will tell you what it is, and you think deeply about this when the meeting is over. The thing which keeps our delusion in place is imagination, which is the world's greatest actor or actress, imagination playing the role of understanding. When you imagine that you understand God, that you understand yourself, that you understand life, that you know what it's all about, you or I am a horror among men. Because having permitted imagination to take the place of capital R reality is to be in a state of horror. And with nice, pleasant smiles and dynamic sermons and best-selling books, I pass my horror on to you, calling it God. What set of beliefs, of ideas, principles, of convictions do you have where you would get upset, defensive and offensive if someone challenged them? If you really know the truth, which you don't, when you really know the truth, can you be challenged? Can anyone upset you? You don't understand this because you don't understand it. When you are living the truth, not simply knowing it in your mind, as Sally said, when you are living it, when you are it, can you be upset by a challenge to it? What causes arguments and fights between one church and another church, between one so-called spiritual group and another spiritual group, between two psychological groups, two schools of psychology? What causes it? People living in imagination who will probably, in all probability, never know that they lived in imagination masquerading as reality, which is your state in this room right now. Which is why I look out and I see sad faces. That's a sign of it. I sometimes see hostile faces. That's a sign of it. I see despairing faces. That's a sign of it. That means you will not give up your imaginations about yourself because you're afraid of the death. You're afraid of the death of your suffering. What on earth is going to free us from imagination, which we don't know we're living from? What is going to shock me out of it? Something has got to do it. If I'm going to change being the kind of a human being I am. This may sound very elementary to you, and I'm not using words to sound clever, but I'll tell you something. You listen to it. In order to change being the kind of human being that you are, you have to change being the kind of human being that you are. Isn't that perfect logic? Imagination is so strong, has us so completely in its power, that I can think that I've changed my life and still behave like an animal. I can be sarcastic and cruel and vicious, mostly hidden, of course, because I'm a coward as well. Don't forget that the devil is a coward. He's sneaky. He'll hit and run. This is characteristic of the devil. He'll hit and run, make a sarcastic remark, yell something out the car window at the other driver and you're gone, huh? Make a sarcastic remark to someone who woke you up at 3 a.m. and slam the phone down and run. Find your own examples. I'm going to have to see that I'm still as miserable in spite of taking the 5-year course in religion, in psychology, in going to all these classes and reading all these books. I'm going to have to see that I walk into that meeting room out of command, because that pretty girl over there has caught my attention, and I suddenly sense that I'm not supposed to look at her because other people are watching me and I'm supposed to be spiritual, and now I'm in conflict. Or I wonder what I'm going to get out of the meeting in a material way, maybe. A new friend, a new girlfriend, a new boyfriend. Or in addition to my egotism, which I will always get as long as I'm false, because I will associate with other false people, and we will lie to each other and destroy the world. Be a part of the destruction of the world. Right so far? What are we going to do? Something drastic has to be done. This, as Juan said, this lying has got to stop. We'll find out now how to start shattering imagination, which is taking the place of my real nature. You can do it with a very simple sentence and putting everything else together that you've learned, obviously. As you go through your day and your night, you catch yourself at odd moments saying the following to yourself as an exercise, as an experiment on yourself. You say to yourself, whatever happened to, and then fill in the blank, we'll see. Whatever happened to, fill in the blank. Whatever happened to my feeling of confidence that I had earlier this morning? Whatever happened to my feeling that I'm on the right track at last in my spiritual studies? Whatever happened to my hope that I had 10 minutes ago? Whatever happened to it? This will show you so many things. Among them, it will prove that you were living in imagination when you had this hope, when you had this so-called confidence, when you had this feeling of so-called feeling of self-assurance. It will prove to you, once and for all, that it was imagination. It was an imaginary confidence, an imaginary feeling of feeling good, because it disappeared, didn't it? It passed away, it went away. Can truth have an opposite? Can it lose itself? See? Ha! I felt good after meeting those people because they affirmed me. They agreed with me. They told me what a nice man I was, what a nice woman I was. I felt real good. I was sound asleep and didn't know it, living in imagination. But 2 hours later, when I went home alone, I felt depressed. There's something wrong somewhere. You know, do you understand? I'm sure you do, that most human beings never even get to this stage of self-examination. They don't want it at all, but we're doing it, so this is for us. Whatever happened to it, this will let you see that it was simply on the level of ordinary thought, which you identified with. You said, I am confident. You weren't confident at all. You were labeling yourself confident because for that moment you felt an affirmation of your false sense of self. Affirmation in quote marks. Because you can't affirm an illusion. This is the beginning of the shock. To see that I've paraded around with all these beautiful ideas of how worthy I am. And when you begin to see it in yourself, you'll see it in other people. And I'm sure that all of you here could give me examples of how you've seen it in other people or in yourself. And I'll give you just one. But it's a very good one because it's a fundamental one. I once knew a woman, and you would have to classify her as extremely neurotic, a very sick human being in every way. And very blithely and lightly, she told me how much love she had to give to a man. She was a widow, and she was looking for another man, I guess, but she was just telling me how much love she had to give to a man, that poor man who ever married her. Imagination of being a woman of tremendous resources of love for some other, of course, worthy human being who was worthy of her. And sick, sick, sick. Now, that's her. How about the man who lives in imagination, that if he runs for public office or if he becomes an authority of some kind, that he can help people straighten out the economic mess, the political mess? Same thing. Find your own examples, and then find the examples in yourself. And now I'll ask you, why do you have to think about yourself at all? And of course, I'm not talking about getting a glass of water when you're thirsty or putting on a jacket when it's chilly or being careful when you drive your car. Why do you have to think about yourself at all? Tell me. I'd like you to tell me. You don't know because there is no answer to it. Because when I think about myself, always, always, I will go into imagination, plus all the other things that are wrong with me, confused emotions, unhealthy emotions, craving to have you like me, to be accepted by you, hopeful that you won't hurt me or leave me. Look, can you, through understanding all this, understanding the whole business, put a complete end to what is commonly called self-centeredness and egotism in order, as Joan said, to henceforth live as a decent human being for the rest of my life? Because the way I've lived it up until this point has not been very decent, has it? Never mind what you've done to other people, which has been terrible. What an animal you were. How cruel you were. How heartless. What have you done to yourself? the same thing that you did to them, the very same thing. Right?
Right.
So our purpose in this group, and particularly this morning, is to start becoming psychic detectives, to begin to question the power, let me rephrase it, to begin to question my assumption based on imagination that I am this or that kind of a person, and to drop both sides. Which, it may astonish you to discover that this is God, that this is truth, and you have become that. Which we could have seen a long time ago, except that we didn't know enough and didn't put into practice the idea of dropping imagination when it screamed out and said, I am necessary to your psychic survival. And we were gullible enough to believe imagination when it said that. Now, what is meant by that? Answer to yourself, please, the following questions. During the past week, have you had your feelings hurt? During the past week, have you become angry? During the past week, have you been rude to anyone, which means you are afraid? During the past week, have you been gloomy or depressed? During the past week, have you felt that you were the victim of human power of another person? In every single instance of this, imagination was operating wrongly. There is a right use of imagination, which we won't go into now. But imagination was operating wrongly and egotistically, making you think that misery is necessary, and all the miserable people in your life will agree with that because they love their misery and want you to stay as miserable as they are. The devil loves the devil. We're here to continue the figure of speech. We're here to find that one small angel inside of us and then associate only with angels. Which, if you listened to the talk last night, can begin with a very mild or small type of angel, which is a right thought, a right idea. A right idea is that imagination parades as reality. That's a right idea. And then we can go to higher ideas, and then we come to the point where ideas themselves cease. Except when I feel thirsty and turn on the tap in the kitchen, I have the idea I must turn on the tap in order to get a glass of water. Then idea will operate, but in no other way. In other words, ideas will not have self-reference. They will not say sentences such as the following. What is going to become of me 5 years from now? How am I going to get over my guilt of those terrible things I did 10 years ago? Do I have the intelligence to grasp these things? You might say fearfully. Don't you know that even when you're in despair over getting these things, that's what prevents you from getting them? Can any good thing come out of despair? No. So why don't you just drop it? Why don't you give it up? Why don't you give up your despair? Which you have, by the way. not only here, but in other ways. You're living in imaginary security. I will repeat. All of you in this room are living in imaginary security. And I'll tell you how I know no. Because I, or some other person, can say something to you and your face drops. You cry, or you get scared, or you fight, or you get defensive, or you do something else like that. That's how I know you're living in imaginary security, so you find it out. Touchiness. Do you know how gentle this class is and why it is necessary to be very gentle in this class at the same time that we're tough? Because you would cry and you would run away, and so you can't be given that strong a shock yet. You're here to be able to take more and more every time you come to class, and by that means we finally find our way out. We finally find our way out of an imaginary life which we thought, which we would have sworn was real. Question, and then we'll stop. Ask yourself right now, each of you, what is it really like living with me? What is it really like living with you, with yourself? Now, regardless of all the spiritual books you've read, and the churches you've gone to, and how much you know about religion, I ask you again, and I ask those of you listening to this tape, don't you see a contradiction between what you think you know and the way your life is? Absolutely, finally. When you have the courage, as was said earlier, to give up loving your misery, you will become a new human being right here on earth. You have the courage to give up your tears. Never mind thinking about it, give it up. Do you have the courage to give up your secret rude comments to other people? Do you have the courage to give that up? You know what I mean. You do it all the time. You should know. Do you have the courage to give up your sarcasm? Do you have the courage to give up your fighting of anything or anyone? Do you have the courage to just drop it, let it go? If so, you'll have a miracle that you can't imagine and shouldn't imagine, but which will be a new reality for you. And then you'll have made it. And that won't be imagination. That will be a life. All right, let's have open discussion, maybe questions, but stick to the topic for now, at least at the start. Stick to the theme, the topic of imagination parading as reality. I call myself a nice person, a pretty nice person. The very calling of myself a pretty nice person is imagination, which means I'm not nice at all, because I am never nice. When I, quote marks, am nice, there will be an opposite to that. I am nice, for example, because I want something from you. And once I get it, I don't care whether I'm nice to you now or not anymore. I've got what I want, now I'll run with it, and find some other gullible victim who's on the same level as I am, But of course, they're very mean if they take me first. You don't really see what I'm talking about. You hear the words, but you don't know that you're living in imagination because it is that deep. It has its clutches in us that deep. So let's explore it a little bit and see what we come up with. All right, I'll give you a diving board. I want to see hands now, before you did put up your hands. How many of you had your feelings hurt this week? Your feelings hurt in one way or another. How many of you have been rude to someone else this week? Huh? Either mentally or outwardly. You don't do it here because you get slapped down. How many were mentally rude? How many were outwardly rude? Joan, you're raising your hand.
I qualify on all counts.
How many of you, and I'll get you now. How many of you were afraid this week? You're in bad shape, Joan. All right, that means you're living in imagination instead of from reality, instead of from the W capital whole. What is a simpler test than that? There's no simpler test. This is the way I am. But will I now lie about it? Or will I be so asleep that I'm not even interested in exploring this? Think of that topic for a moment. Most human beings are so immersed in psychic sleep, in psychic hypnosis, that they have the slightest interest in exploring their state as a means of getting out of it, as a means of changing it. This is why there's a relatively small room full of people here this morning instead of thousands of people. Who's going to change themselves when they're already okay? Huh? Nobody. I'm okay. You're okay. As if you really are. Dick?
Well, going back to that question you asked, why do you have to think about yourself at all? And realizing that in the state we're in, that seems like an impossible question.
Yes.
So my question would be then, and of course you've said you've given us many hints, but the only thing we can really do is just to try to grasp what that means and then work with the things we hear here.
Look, if all I know is self-reference, everything revolves around me, the world revolves around me and what I want, what I've got to have, how other people should treat me. If that is my world, how are you going to tell me about another world if this is all I know? Talk about an impossible situation, but we'll put the impossible in quotes, otherwise it'd be hopeless. And it is far from hopeless. It is quite hopeful, if you want to use that word. I'll repeat the old illustration, which you've heard many times before. You can't talk to a summer insect about ice, right? Okay, it's an old proverb. All right. How are you going to talk to a man who gets up in the morning, and the minute he gets up, his mind starts churning? He's a businessman, say. Just say he's a businessman, businesswoman. Equal rights, right? Businesswoman, businessman. He gets up, and driving down to the office or to the factory or wherever, his mind is churning the way it has been doing ever since childhood about what he's going to get for himself this day in order to feel better. I'm going to get a whole lot of more money. I'm going to ask for a raise. I'm going to get a promotion. I'm going to be accepted by people. I heard a good joke last night at the lunch break where we're all sitting around the coffee table in the company cafeteria. I'll tell this joke and I'll get a laugh, and they'll all think I'm a nice fella. Do you think he's going to listen to you when you tell him about this? You can't talk to a summer insect about ice. That is, about something that is totally different from what he knows. Now do you see why certain teachers emphasize the fact that you must leap into the unknown and not take the known and call it another world when it's simply your same world in another disguise? You now have a new husband, a new wife, or you live in a new state, or you have a new set of religious principles, so you go around knocking on doors. I'll tell you, how about this? From now on, you and I will get up in the morning, working hard on ourselves, making our minds work all right, but making them work to see that we were in imagination all the time instead of living from ourselves. Because this imaginary life is not a real life at all. Let's put the energy into this now instead of that. Because it's, I would say, that it is incredibly difficult. And that's not to discourage us, actually, but to keep us, as Juan said, to keep us honest, because out of that honesty of seeing how difficult it is, we can destroy the illusion that if I just read the book one more time, I'll get it. You won't. Or if I get some material object, then I'll have it made. You won't.
I look at this as being laziness. We always look to other people as, helping us out. And we don't want to take the blame ourselves, like Juan says about lying, you know. We don't want to blame it onto us. We say, well, it's Joe over there that's at fault, not me. So we're lying to ourselves.
Correct. Oh, can you take it a little bit this morning? Thank you, Al. You led me right into something. Oh, boy. Brace yourself. How many of you have told a lie in the last week?
I've got the apple tree.
I took your names down. Those. How many of you have deceived someone else this week?
Knowingly. Well, we knew.
All right. Anyway. What, Rudy? A loud and clear, please.
Well, Dick and I have a game going. You said once, long time ago, how nice we are after we've hurt someone. And I always noticed that I'd say to Al afterwards, honey, sweetheart, see? So I said to Dick, a few weeks ago, something about if Kathy wasn't here, and now I just asked him as he noticed if he called Kathy honey this week, he evaded me though.
All right. Go ahead. Mm-hmm.
It seems to me that growth in the work is a series of falling off one's own pedestal.
Yes, very good.
And this thinking that we know becomes so subtle that I notice that it's not till after I've fallen off my current pedestal that I realize that I thought I knew there, but I didn't think I knew when I was up there.
Right, exactly. That was good. That was fine. Wasn't that good? We only begin to sense it when we get knocked off or fall off. But then what do? Lie about it. You have no business pushing me off the pedestal which great me so richly deserves in this world, etc., etc. This is the shock we're talking about, being pushed off it. This is what we're trying to do here. This is what each one of us is trying to do when we get up in the morning, to push ourselves off of this pedestal by thinking of what the world owes us. You owe me is neurotic and imagination. Anything at all. And that is also, and you'll agree with this, won't you? That is also a violent statement. You owe me. Isn't there violence in that? Because if you don't give that to me, yeah, watch out. What do you want to do with the rest of your life? You want to go back to sleep? Or do you want to permit this group and permit yourself and permit all events to knock you off the pedestal, so that when you're lying down there bruised and feeling sorry for yourself, one small bit of intelligence might enter into it and say, what an idiot I am for having had that imagination about myself, that I'm a beautiful person, loyal, true, kindly, generous, and it was all a lie. If I can see what a liar I am, there is hope for me.
The reason that we're on the pedestal and the chief quality of this imagination that you're talking about is the vain presumption of the part that it should be in command of the whole.
Right.
That it's complete confusion and contradiction. Now, if you take just the simple phrase, child of God, to be a real child of God means the child is waiting for instructions, you know. He is in tune with, in touch with, he is, to use a different word phrase, passive to, looking for guidance toward the all or toward the truth.
Okay, all right.
That's only one phrase. Another phrase has occurred to me this morning, which connects with everything we're talking about, but in a different corner. Whitman, in one of his poems, says, there's been no priest ever who had any greater feeling for God than I do, but with the mystery of God, I dare not dally.
Okay. Let me add to that. Now I'm going to give you a fact. This is not imagination. This is a fact. This is a right idea. This is right encouragement. And I'm saying something that I've said before, but in a different way. This is a fact. Now don't think it's too much. It isn't. This is tremendous. Everything you need to learn, you can learn from yourself. That's right. You have the kingdom of heaven within. Everyone in this room. Everyone. That's not imagination. That's fact. That is fact. Now let's not confuse imagination with fact. Let's see what preliminary steps we have to take in order to really see this. Then, as Leland said, in his own way, I can begin to learn from me. Because the real me is truth itself, right? Not this imaginary self, which pretends to know. And I'll repeat for the 50th time, I can begin to detect when I am pretending to know, when I get angry and scared when you challenge me, right? I have my religious belief. And I go from door to door peddling it. And you argue with me, I get scared. And I argue back. Why? I don't know the truth at all. I just have a bunch of nonsensical ideas which I've identified with and which is hardened as imagination about myself. And when you challenge it, my imaginary picture starts to tremble and I'm afraid I'm going to get knocked off the pedestal. So in order to keep it in place, I argue and fight and quote the Bible, and already I feel better. I feel better, and I'm destroying myself.
Copyright 1974. No portion of this material may be reproduced or sold without permission from Bruno Associates, Garden Grove, California.